With the rise of technology comes a new type of danger. The internet can be a powerful tool to be used for good intent, or it can lead down a much darker path. On April 13th, 2009, someone responded to Talissa Brisman's Craigslist ad in Boston, Massachusetts. Little did she know what awaited her. She used the name Morgan, and he was Andy. Both were fictitious names. Talissa didn't want the men who answered her ads to know her real name, and she assumed her clientele did the same. Andy found Talissa's listing as a masseuse in the Craigslist Erotic Services section. They agreed to meet up at 10 p.m. the next day on April 14th. Talissa had just sealed her fate. A friend of Talissa's who knew about her meeting texted her multiple times throughout the night to make sure she was okay. At 7:10 the next morning, after not hearing back from Talissa, she called security at the Marriott Copley Place and was transferred to the Boston Police. She told officers that she had helped set up the meeting and could provide the email and address of Andy. Mark Roche, who was the former head of the Computer Crime Unit at the U.S. Department of Justice, was also contacted and immediately went to work with aiding the police. Talissa Brisman was found in a room at the Marriott with her head bashed in, apparently from the butt of a gun, and three gunshot wounds to her heart, chest, and abdomen. A woman in a nearby room, after hearing shrieks, went out into the hallway and saw a body sprawled across the doorway of Brisman's room. A piece of plastic zip tie was hanging from one wrist. 4 days earlier, Boston police had received a report of another masseuse named Tricia Leffler. Leffler was staying at Weston Copley Place. She stated that on April 10th, she had met with a tall blonde male in his 20s who had answered an ad of hers on Craigslist.
I got a call a little bit after midnight. He said, "How much is it?" I told him, you know, $200 for the hour. He said, "Okay." Tall, blonde, good-looking gentleman. I just said, "Hi, how are you?" And he said, "Good." I said, "All right, come on," and motioned him to follow me into the room. I shut the door, I turned around and I locked it. That's when he pulled out the gun. And he said, "Lay down, put your hands behind your back." And then when he started to walk towards me, he put the gun back in his pocket. He knelt down with one knee in between my legs and took my wrist and put the tie around one of them first, and then he tied the other one. I had about $800 in cash. He grabbed that, put that in his pocket.
2 days after Brisman's murder, 40 miles away from Boston in Warwick, Rhode Island, Cynthia Melton, a stripper who advertised lap dances on Craigslist and danced at the Cadillac Lounge, made an appointment to see a man that had answered her ad through the erotic services section. Their meeting was scheduled at 11 p.m. at the Warwick Holiday Inn Express. Once inside her room, the client pulled a gun and made her lie face down on the floor and bound her with the same type of plastic ties that were used on Brisman and Leffler. He tried to stuff a ball gag in her mouth, but she put up a struggle until her assailant stopped trying to silence her. Cynthia informed authorities that the perpetrator was a tall, blonde young man who seemed very nervous and was trembling as he searched the room for cash and credit cards. Cynthia's husband, Keith Melton, would accompany her when she performed lap dances for clients. He was in the lobby downstairs waiting for Cynthia to let him know that her appointment was over. When he didn't hear from her when he expected, he went back to the room and knocked on the door. When Keith entered the room, the assailant pointed the gun at him and ran out the door, fleeing down a nearby stairwell. One of the assailant's texts was traced to a nearby Walmart, where he bought the baseball hat he wore during the attempted robbery. The police searched the hotel's surveillance recordings to see who appeared on them just after the killing of Talissa Brisman. Surveillance showed a tall, blonde, white male matching Tricia Leffler's description. The subject was looking down at his phone while walking from the Marriott Copley elevators. Surveillance at the Weston Copley revealed what appeared to be the same man texting while leaving that hotel at the same time of the Leffler robbery. Boston law enforcement started tracking down the true identity of Andy. Through a court order, they were able to get the IP address from Microsoft that the Live.com account used to send the emails on Craigslist. Craigslist was then able to link that IP address to the time and date of each posting from the live.com address. The IP address came back to an internet service provider in the Boston area. The provider was able to give the police the name and address of the customer that was assigned that IP address. 8 High Point Circle in Quincy, Massachusetts, a suburb of Boston. After finding the location, Mark Roche went to Google and Facebook to find out who their suspect was and what he looked like. They were shocked at what they found. Philip Markoff, a tall, blonde, second-year medical student at Boston University. He had no criminal record and was engaged to be married in a year. Roche and his team staked out his home. When he saw Markoff and his fiancée come out and get in a car, they started following the couple. They were traveling on Interstate 95 in Walpole, Massachusetts. Normally, they would watch their suspect longer, but they weren't sure how far they were going. If they left the state, they would lose control of the situation. His fiancée thought they were being pulled over for speeding. She had shared an apartment with Markoff for the past 7 months, but had been away when the crimes were committed. Police concluded that she had no idea about Markoff's criminal activities. The couple were on their way to Foxwoods Casino in Connecticut. Markoff had about $1,600 in cash on him, and this would have been his 19th visit to Foxwoods in the last 4 months. Police arrested Markoff, and investigators went to search his apartment. The gun that the police believe had killed Jalissa Brisman was hidden in a hollowed-out copy of the medical textbook, Grey's Anatomy. They also found plastic zip ties and bullets that matched those removed from Brisman's body. 4 pairs of women's underwear were found hidden in the box spring of the couple's bed. There were multiple track phones and a laptop computer that contained Markoff's responses to Brisman's Craigslist posting. They also found 45 $100 bills and several IDs. His prints were found on the duct tape used to cover Tricia Leffler's mouth and on the walls of the hotel room where he assaulted Cynthia Melton. They also discovered Brisman's blood on his shoes. Later, Tricia Leffler picked him out of a photo lineup. Markoff was indicted on June 22, 2009, in the Suffolk County Superior Court in Boston. Markoff pleaded guilty and was put on suicide watch when marks were found on his neck, thought to be from shoelaces. Authorities concluded that he may have attempted suicide before his arraignment. In August of 2010, while still awaiting trial, Markoff ultimately succeeded in committing suicide. Using his knowledge of human anatomy, he slashed major arteries in his ankles, legs, and neck with a blade he crafted in his cell. He stuffed toilet paper down his throat and covered his head with a plastic bag. As he bled out in his cell, Markoff painted a final bloody message on the wall. His fiancée's name, Megan, and the word, pocket. What the Craigslist killer meant by pocket, the world will never know.